A Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court by Samuel Langhorne Clements, alias Mark Twain. Preface and Stranger's History, Part 1. The ungentle laws and customs touched upon in this tale are historical, and the episodes which are used to illustrate them are also historical. It is not pretended that these laws and customs existed in England in the 6th century. No! It is only pretended that inasmuch as they existed in the English and other civilizations of far later times, it is safe to consider that it is no libel upon the 6th century to suppose them to have been in practice in that day also. One is quite justified in inferring that whatever one of those laws and customs was lacking in that remote time, its place was competently filled by a worse one. The question as to whether there is such a thing as divine right of kings is not settled in this book. It was found too difficult. That the executive head of a nation should be a person of lofty character and extraordinary ability was manifest and indisputable. That none but the deity could select that head unerringly was also manifest and indisputable. That the deity ought to make that selection then was likewise manifest and indisputable. Consequently, that he does make it, as claimed, was an unavoidable deduction. I mean, until the author of this book encountered the Pompadour, a Lady Castlemaine, and some other executive heads of that kind. These were found so difficult to work into the scheme that it was judged better to take the other tack in this book, which must be issued this fall, and then go into training and settle the question in another book. It is, of course, the thing which ought to be settled. And I am not going to make anything particular to do next winter anyway. Mark Twain, Hartford, July the 21st, 1889. A word of explanation. It was in Warwick Castle that I came across the curious stranger whom I am going to talk about. He attracted me by three things: his candid simplicity, his marvelous familiarity with ancient armor, and the restlessness of his company. For he did all the talking. We fell together, as modest people will, in the tail of a herd that was being shown through, and he at once began to say things which interested me. As he talked along, softly, pleasantly, flowingly, he seemed to drift away imperceptibly out of this world and time, and into some remote era and old forgotten country, and so he gradually wove such a spell about me that I seemed to move among the spectres and shadows and dust and mold of grey antiquity, holding speech with a relic of it, exactly as I would speak of my nearest personal friends or enemies, or my most familiar neighbors. He spoke of Sir Bedivere, Sir Bors de Ganis, Sir Lancelot of the Lake, Sir Galahad, and all the other great names of the Table Round, and how old, old, unspeakably old and faded and dry and musty and ancient he came to look as he went on. Presently he turned to me and said, just as one might speak of the weather or any other common matter, "You know about the transmigration of souls. Do you know about transposition of epochs and bodies?" I said I had not heard of it. He was so little interested, just as when people speak of the weather, that he did not notice whether I made him any answer or not. There was half a moment of silence, immediately interrupted by the droning voice of the salaried Ciceron. "Ancient Hamburg, date of the 6th century, time of King Arthur and the Round Table, said to have belonged to the knights of Sagramore de la Desirius. Observe round holes with a chain mail in the breast, can't be accounted for, supposed to have been done with a bullet since the invention of firearms, placed maliciously by Cromwell's soldiers." My acquaintance smiled, not a modern smile, but one must gone out of general use many, many centuries ago, and muttered appreciatively to himself, "Wit ye well, I saw it done." Then, after a pause, added, "I did it myself." By the time I had recovered from the electric surprise of this remark, he was gone. All that evening I sat by my fire at the Warwick Arms, steeped in a dream of the olden time, while the rain beat upon the windows and the wind roared about the eaves and corners. From time to time I dipped into old Thomas Malory's enchanting book and fed at its rich feast of prodigies and adventures, breathed in the fragrance of its obsolete names, and dreamed again. Midnight came come at length, he read another tale for nightcap. That is which here follows, to wit. how Sir Lancelot slew two giants and made a castle free. Anon withal came where upon him two great giants, well armed, all save the heads, with two horrible clubs in their hands. Sir Lancelot put his shield afore him, and put the stroke away of the one giant, and with his claw did cleave his head asunder. When his fellow saw that, he ran away as if he were wood demented, for fear of the horrible strokes. And Sir Lancelot after him with all his might, and smote him on the shoulder, and clapped him to the middle. And Sir Lancelot went into the hall, and there came afore him 80 ladies and damsels, and all kneeled upon him, and thanked God and him of their deliverance. "For, sir," said they, "the most part of us had been here with this 7 years their prisoners, and we worked all manner of silk works for our meat. And we were all great gentlewomen born, and blessed by the time, knight, that ever thou wert born, that thou hast done the most worship that ever did knight in the world, that will bear record. And we will pray you to tell us your name, that we may tell our friends who delivered us out of this prison." "Fair damsels," he said, "my name is Sir Lancelot du Lake." And so he departed from them, and taught them unto God, and then he mounted upon his horse, and rode into many strange and wild countries, and through many waters and valleys, and evil was he lodged. And at the last, by fortune him happened against a knight to come at a fair courtelage, and therein he found an old gentlewoman that lodged him with a good will, and there he had good cheer for him and his horse. And when time was, his host bore him into a fair garret over the gate to his bed. There Sir Lancelot unarmed him, and set his harness by him, and went to bed, and anon he fell on sleep. So soon after that, came one on horseback, and knocked at the gate in great haste. And when Sir Lancelot heard this, he rose up, and looked out at the window, and saw by the moonlight 3 knights come riding after that one man, and all 3 slashed on him at once with swords. And that one knight turned on them knightly, and defeat ended them. "Truly," said Lancelot, "yonder one knight shall I help. For it was shame for me to see 3 knights on one, and if he be slain, I am partnered at his death." And therewith him he took his harness and went out of the street by a sheet down to the 4 knights, and there Sir Lancelot said on high, "Turn you knights unto me, and leave your fighting with that knight." And then they were all 3 left Sir Kay, and turned unto Sir Lancelot, and there began great battle, for they alight all 3, and strake many strokes at Sir Lancelot, and assailed him on every side. Then Sir Kay dressed him that ought to have help, and Sir Lancelot, "Nay, sir," said he, "I will none of your help, therefore as ye will have my help, let me alone with them." Sir Kay, for the pleasure of the knight, suffered him for to do his will, and so stood aside. Then anon within 6 strokes Sir Lancelot had stricken with them to the earth. And then they all 3 cried, "Sir knight, we yield us unto you as a man of might matchless." "As to that," said Sir Lancelot, "I will not take your yielding unto me, and so you yield you unto Sir Kay, the seneschal. On that covenant I will save your lives, and else not." "Fair knight," said they, "we would love to do, for as Sir Kay we chased him hither, and had overcome him, yet ye not been, therefore to yield us unto him it were no reason." "Well, as to that," said Sir Lancelot, "advise you well, for ye may yet choose whether ye will live or die or live, for an ye be yielding, it will be unto Sir Kay." "Fair knight," they said, "in saving our lives we will do as thou commandest us." "Then shall ye," said Sir Lancelot, "and Whitsunday next. Come and go unto the court of King Arthur, and here ye shall yield you unto Queen Guinevere, and put you all 3 in her grace and mercy, and say that Sir Kay sent you thither to be her prisoners." On the morn Sir Lancelot rose early, and left Sir Kay sleeping, and Sir Lancelot took Sir Kay's armour and his shield and armed him. And so he went to the stable, and took his horse, and took his leave of his host, and so he departed. Then soon after arose Sir Kay, and missed Sir Lancelot, and then he espied that he had his armour and horse. Now by my fault I know well that he will grieve some of the court of King Arthur, and also on some of him lights will be closer or bold, and deem that it was as I, and that I will beguile them, and because of his armour and shield I am sure I shall light in peace. And then soon after departed Sir Kay, and thanked his host. As I laid the book down, there was another knock at the door, and my stranger came in. I gave him a pipe and a chair, and made him welcome. I also comforted him with hot Scotch whiskey, gave him another one, and then still another, hoping always for his story. After a poor persuader, he drifted into it himself in a quiet, simple, and natural way. End of part one of Preface and Stranger's History.